Hello and welcome to part 4 of Pulling the Perfect Key in Avid with me, Ben Brownlee from Boris FX. And in this section, we're going to be looking at starting to tie the foreground and the background clip together. So the first thing I want to do is actually try and get a bit of color correction going in. So just do a bit of primary color correction just to balance the two elements out. And if I pop back into Primatte Studio on my foreground clip, we'll take a little look at that one there. We can come in and start to have a look at some of the other modules we have down at the bottom. Essentially, we have four ways of correcting color. We have our main color correction, we have our light wrap color correction, which we're going to look at in a slightly later exercise, and we have our edge color correction only. I'm going to start, obviously, with the primary color correction. So this is the color correction that goes over the top of our entire foreground clip. And I can change up things like temperature to match up the temperature. I can make things a little bit cooler or a little bit warmer. I'll probably make things just a tad cooler here just to cool things down. If we just take a look at the background itself, it looks like quite a cold day. We don't have lots of sunshine shining through here. The ground looks a bit wet, or at least a bit damp. And that's the sort of feel I also want to have in my foreground as well. So I take the temperature down a little bit cooler. The tint I can then move between green and magenta. And I might want to again just touch that a little bit closer towards the greens. Then I have my saturation, so I can make this super saturated. Ugh, horrible. Or I can just kind of match this in. I'm going to come back to saturation in just a moment. So I'll just leave that near the center, if not at the center. And then we have the three controls to control our brightness and contrast. So I have brightness itself, which again, I'm going to leave just in zero. If I want to keep the black and the white levels generally where they are, use the gamma instead. And I'm going to use a combination of contrast and gamma, or get me into the right sort of brightness and contrast levels where I want to be. I actually quite like this slightly more contrasted look. It does make our nave stick even more out of the background. So, you know, if this isn't the look you want, if you wanted to have a sort of even more realistic, we can even come in and sort of maybe touch the contrast down a little bit, and in the same way, take the gamma down a bit as well. So this sort of fits in a bit better with the black levels that we have going on in the original. And actually, this probably isn't all that bad. I think I'm going to keep us there, actually. And that's the before and after. Before and after. But I reserve the right to revisit this once we've added a few more elements on top. Okay, so that's our first bit of color correction. I'm now going to turn my focus onto the background instead. So one of the things, we take a look at the background here. One of the things we can see if we just look at the background itself, the focal point in the background is probably around about the plane of this tree here. You can see that the stuff in front is definitely out of focus, and the stuff at the back, far in the distance, is also out of focus, but this is relatively in focus. And that doesn't fit in for where we are with our nave. Our nave is much closer to the camera, so this doesn't make sense. So what I'm going to do is add another effect over the top, just to sort of tie things together a little bit more. And let's come over to our effect palette, and I will find a blur. And I'm going to use the Continuum Fast Lens Blur. And let's pop into the effect editor and take a look at this. The default iris scale of 15 is pretty high. You can see that it's blurring out a lot. We probably only need a touch of this. And I'll take this down to about 4-ish. That should be fine. Actually, let's just preview that out a bit more. Now, one of the other things we can do with the fast lens blur is we can boost the highlights up so that it starts reacting in a sort of more realistic way. If you defocused a camera, than if you just stuck a Gaussian blur across an image. So I'm going to take the highlight threshold down until we start seeing, there we go, start seeing the areas in the background there. And I can boost those up to a place that I quite like. And I'm going to soften those out as well. I can even change the way that this boost works. Boost it all the way to white, or just do an RGB glow. And I kind of like that RGB glow. And that's without the soften and with the soften. So I find a nice medium there. You see what a big difference that makes as I bring the iris scale back up again. We see a little bit more of the lens shape there. You know, obviously we don't really want that. I'm still going to just bring that iris scale down again. Yeah, that's starting to look pretty good there. Now, the problem I've got with this as it is at the moment is that it still just looks like we've put a blur across the entire background image, which is essentially what we've done. But built into the continuum fast blur, we do have our pixel chooser. Now, we started to talk a little about what the pixel chooser can do when we were looking at hold in and hold out masks back in exercise 3. If I turn my pixel chooser on now, I'm just going to solo out the background. The pixel chooser's there to limit where the effect is going to be placed. And we can do that in one of two different ways. We can either use a matte based off of, Luma or one of the color channels or even the alpha channel, or making our own little key. Or we can do it based off of a mask. And we've got various mask shapes, including a mocha spline, if we want to do that. Or we can do some sort of gradients as well. So if I do a linear gradient, and let's turn the iris scale back up even more there, you can see what that's doing. There we go, to our image. So we can wipe that on. If we don't want to use a linear gradient, we want it to affect both sides differently, we can use a linear double edge gradient and turn my gradient distance down. You can see that that's spreading out from one side. And I can even come around and rotate that out a little bit. So we'll start that in the middle. Wipe it a little bit there. So change the gradient distance up. I can view my matte masks. You can see exactly what it's meant to be doing. Something around about there, so sort of blends into the center, then back out again, which should look quite nice. I'll turn off, view matte mask. I'll come back in, bring my iris scale down again. Probably need this a little bit more over on the edges. It's not quite doing what I need it to do in the edges, so I'll just bring the distance up a little bit more there. So take that to about, 150-ish? 130. Yeah, that's looking all right. And let's see how it looks with the composite. I can bypass it before and after, before and after. So we're starting to get somewhere with this now. Now it's beginning to fit in a bit better now. What I could do is, if you have a little look at what's happening in the foreground, let's just bypass the lens blur. You can see that at the start of the clip, our guy's out of focus, and then he comes into focus around about 1 second in. So we can replicate that on the blur as well. So if I just come in and I add a keyframe, and we come to the start, I'll add another keyframe and just reduce the iris scale down a little bit there. We can get that feeling of the rack focus as the background goes more out of focus and bringing the foreground into focus. But should help to sell the shot a little bit more. And with just a couple of little tweaks, we've come quite far from where we started at the beginning of this exercise. Looking at this now, if I wanted to do one more thing to it, actually, I might just add on a fast flip. So we use the fast flipper, and I'll hold down Alt onto the background and just flip my trees over onto the other side. So we can see a little bit more of the background over there. It's a small thing, but I think it helps to sell the shot, because if you look, we've got the light coming in over on the right-hand side here. And without the fast flipper, bypass that, our light is really more coming in over from the left-hand side. So at least we've got an idea of light popping through over here. And that's something we're going to build on in exercise 5, where we're going to be looking at matching lighting to try to bring this whole thing together. And we're going to use a couple more effects that are found within the Boris Continuum package to help sell that, including a bit of lens flare and some particle effects. All right, so that's been looking at primary balance in part 4. Join me, Ben Brownlee from Boris FX, in part 5 of pulling the perfect key in Avid. Thanks for watching. If you have any questions or comments about Primatte Studio or any of the other things that you've seen in this video, then please leave them below. To learn more about Primatte Studio or any of the Continuum filters, then join us over at borisfx.com.